In the Genus project off the coast of Namibia, the research group led by marine biologist Holger Aul is investigating the zooplankton in detail. The aim of the work is to thoroughly survey the crustaceans present in the area. How many different species of copepods and decapods are there in the Benguela Upwelling System? And what are they? To catch enough examples, the researchers from the University of Bremen use a multiple opening-closing net.
This allows us to collect samples from various depth layers so that we know exactly which depths the animals come from. This is important because we want to do experiments with the animals, and for this we need the precise water temperature in which they occur in the wild. This is why we must know what depth they're from. On this trip, we can also benefit from the work of the other study teams that deploy different nets, especially with the decapods, the shrimps, and the larger crustaceans. They are so scarce that they aren't normally caught with our small net, and we get them out of the bigger nets from the other study groups.
For example, this large specimen of a decapod was caught at night with a ring trawl. The researchers believe there are around 10 different species of decapod in the Benguela system.
So far, we don't know yet exactly what species it is, but we have identification keys, and now we will try to determine the species. To identify a decapod, you can look at various features. You can see whether these segments overlap or not. Then you can see whether the legs have pincers or not, and if so, how many. Then you can look at the shape and size of the eyes, and you can also look at whether there are any points or teeth present at the end of the body.
Copepods and decapods play an important role in the ecosystem because they occur in large numbers and represent an important food source for larger organisms. A key objective of the Genus project is to clarify what copepods and decapods themselves feed on. To find this out, the researchers must carry out extensive studies, partly in the laboratory in Germany.
You could actually investigate this with classic methods in which you either run feeding experiments or look at what the animals have in their stomachs. There is, however, the problem that this is always only a snapshot and can be somewhat biased by what the animals eat in the end of the net, where they are very close together while being captured. This is why we investigate it with what are known as trophic biomarkers. These are either fatty acids or stable isotopes, which are taken in with the food and incorporated into the body tissue. You can basically sum it up with the phrase, you are what you eat, which means nutritional components are incorporated into the body matter, enabling us to draw conclusions about the animal's food.
The key questions for the researchers in the Genus project don't just concern food composition. In order to be able to make statements about how much the animals eat, studies into food quantities are also carried out.
There are a variety of methods. The obvious method would be to carry out feeding experiments. In other words, the animals are fed. However, this is relatively complicated. You must always offer the right food, but you cannot provide the natural food. This is why we have agreed as part of the Genus project that we will not determine the feeding rate directly, but instead take oxygen consumption measurements, known as respiration measurements, and afterwards calculate food intake from the oxygen consumption using a mathematical algorithm. This is basically the same as for us humans. We have to breathe because we burn our food with the oxygen we absorb in breathing. And it's exactly the same for crustaceans.